Good morning. Good morning, friends, and welcome to Johns Creek Baptist Church. I am so happy to see you on this holiday weekend and glad that you have joined us for worship. If you are visiting with us and it is your first time here or fairly new here, and you haven't let us know a little bit about you, we would love to know more about you. And in the pew rack in front of you, there is a blue welcome card. We would love for you to fill that out, to drop it in the offering plate as it comes by later in the service, or even better, at the end of our worship service, our pastors will be here at the front and a couple in the back, and we would love for you to hand that welcome card to a pastor and let us meet you face to face. We would love to say hello to you and welcome you in person. Today is a special week in the life of our church. We have a longtime mission partner in Presidio, Texas. We have been going for 16 years to Presidio to do baseball and softball camps with the teenagers of Presidio, and we are so delighted that they are coming here to Johns Creek this week. And I want to specifically thank all of you who have volunteered to host them in your homes, to be present with us during the day as we do fun activities, and we are so excited that they are arriving tomorrow night between 6 and 8 p.m. We're going to have a welcome party for them. So if you don't have anything to do and you want to come eat cake and enjoy that with us, welcome them to town. We would love for you to come and join us here at the church as we welcome them to Johns Creek. And please be in prayer for all of our team who will be with them all week celebrating and just showing them how much we love them and how much Jesus loves them. This is a very special week for us, and we're so thankful for all the ways that you've played a part in that. We are still taking up school supplies for the Place of Forsyth. Our school supplies are going to middle and high school students whose families are in need in our community. You guys have done a great job of that so far. We've got stacks of supplies in our mission closet, and we are going to continue to collect those through July 21st. So as you're out shopping this week, if you want to pick up a few of those supplies, there are bins in the lobby, and there's a list of the items that we're collecting. We would love for you to continue to do that for the next couple of weeks. And then also, please don't forget that everything that we do at our church, all of the missions and the ministries of our church happen because of your generosity. We are so thankful for all of the ways that you give, and we want to remind you to continue to give even when you're gone on vacation. You're sitting at the lake, you're at the beach. Don't forget that your church is back at home continuing to do missions and ministries. So thank you for all of your generosity and the way that you do that. This worship service is starting out with a celebration of baptism, which is one of the most beautiful things that we do together. So let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we celebrate baptism together.
Today is indeed a special day as we celebrate two awesome baptisms. This is my friend Devin. Devin is going into third grade, fourth grade?
Third.
Going into third grade. And I have known Devin since COVID. So I met him and his mom during COVID, and they started coming as soon as we opened back up. And today, Devin is here because he loves Jesus, and he wants to follow Jesus for the rest of his life. So if you are a friend of Devin, or a friend who's like family to Devin, would you please stand? Look at those people who love you. And if you are the church family, would you please stand? All right, we're going to turn you. All right, Devin, are you here today because you love Jesus and you want to follow him the rest of your life?
Yes.
And what is your confession?
Jesus is Lord.
That's right. one hand here, reach around. I baptize you, Devin Vasir, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Good job, buddy. Devin, the Bible tells us that we are the salt of the earth, so go ahead and taste that salt. That means that we make the world a better place by loving and following Jesus. The Bible also tells us that we are the light of the world. So go and carry the light and love of Christ with you everywhere you go. This is my friend Heather. You may have a seat, sorry. This is my friend Heather, and this is Devin's mom. So in early 2021, I got an email from Heather that said, "Hi, my son is asking some questions about God, and I'm not really sure how to answer them. Are you open?" And unfortunately, I had to say, no, not yet. But we have a Lenten journey box we're doing with our families. Can I bring one by? And so since that day, Heather and her family have been coming to worship, and we are so excited that today she is here to tell the world that she also loves Jesus and wants to follow Jesus the rest of her life. If you are a friend of Heather or a friend that is like family for Heather, would you please stand? And if you are the church family, would you please stand? All right, Heather, I'm going to ask you some questions. Are you here because you love Jesus and you want to follow Jesus the rest of your life?
Yes.
And what is your confession?
Jesus is Lord.
That's right. Upon your profession, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Good job. Heather, Scripture tells us that we are the salt of the earth. This means we make the world a better place by following Jesus. Scripture also tells us that we are the light of the world. So go and carry the light and love of Christ everywhere you go. You may be seated. These are the waters of baptism, and there is always room for more.
It's time now to turn our hearts towards worship as we sing together of our great Redeemer. Please stand.
Our Redeemer and His wondrous love to
Our God.
Pray together. God, it is so true that you are so, so good to us. From the moment that we wake up until we lay our heads down at night, our lives are filled with your faithfulness and your goodness to us. And we are so grateful that you are present through every moment of our lives. From the days that we are full of celebration, that joy is abundant and overflowing, from the breath of a brand new baby, from celebrating the birthdays of those that are oldest among us, for every good family picnic and every holiday gathering, we are so grateful for your abundant goodness in our lives. Lord, we are also aware that you are present every day through every struggle, through every moment of illness, through every moment of grief that seems so overwhelming, we wonder if it will ever end. Through every heartbreak that we don't know how to walk the next step through, we know that you are present. We do not take one of those steps alone because you are by our side. And for that, we will be always grateful. Lord, our world is hurting. We are full of war, division among us. And we know that peace that surpasses all understanding only comes from you. And so, God, on this day, we pray for your peace, for you to show us how to live in harmony with one another, that you will show us how to live intentionally with goodness in our hearts for each other. Help us to be your peacemakers, your love bearers, your goodness in the world in which you have placed us. We are thankful, Lord, for your abundant love for us. Help it to transform us in such a way that we share it with everyone we come in contact with. It is for this beautiful day and for all of the ways that you walk with us that we give you praise and glory. In the name of Jesus, who loves us more than we could ever imagine, we offer our prayers. Amen.
Before the throne of
strong and perfect plea, a great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his heart, my name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart, no tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there, who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, for God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me, to look on him and pardon me. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the spotless righteousness, the great unchangeable I am, the King of glory and of grace. One with himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood, my life is hid with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God, with Christ my Savior and my God. Alleluia, alleluia, praise the one risen Son. Praise the one risen Son of God.
What happens when we live God's way? He brings gifts into our lives, much the same way that fruit appears in an orchard. As we mature in Christ, our lives gradually begin to look more like His. The strength of His character and the beauty of His Spirit become our own. The same transforming love that was in Him gradually cultivates a life of holy fruitfulness in us. This fruitfulness is not something we develop. It is something that is developed in us as we yield daily to the power of His Spirit working within.
Well, well. Good morning, everybody. It is really good to see you here. Glad you're here today. You know, we began celebrating Independence Day several days ago on Thursday. And it's been a long period of time for celebration, several days, right? We show up here this morning and we are partied out. We are hot dogged out. We are sun drenched. Some of us are not at all looking forward to having to go back to work tomorrow. But here we are. And we're here, I think, ultimately because we know in our hearts that there's always a possibility when we gather here and we come into the presence of God that there's an opportunity for new life. And so here we are. We may be tired and a little bedraggled, but we are here together. And I was just thinking about new life, actually, as I was sitting there. What an incredible thing that is. And can we just celebrate the newness of life just for a second before we jump into our sermon for this morning? I'm looking at Jason and Caroline Barnwell over here. They brought a baby into this world. It seems like yesterday, Caroline. Yeah, it was not long ago, a brand new baby into their family and into the life of this church. And I see Heather and Devin over there. The newness of life that's available in Christ as they testified before us this morning with their baptism. This newness of life that is a part of who we are should never, ever be taken for granted by us. It is an incredibly beautiful gift. I'm glad to see you here this morning. And today we are going to continue our summer series titled Fruitful. And it is, of course, a study of the fruits of the Spirit as we find in the New Testament. And we know, and we're all aware, that this, for many of us, is a very familiar text. The fruits of the Spirit is not anything new for a good many of us in this room. In fact, along the way, I imagine most of us memorized these verses somewhere along the way, Sunday school or vacation Bible school or somewhere we memorized it. It's not new to most of us, but I think it's good. I think it's really good for us. As a body of believers and as a family of faith and as followers of Jesus, to not hesitate to go back into the familiar text because there's always something new there. God's word, in my opinion, is dynamic and continues to be inspired, and there's something new for us to discover all the time. I think about the man who was by himself in a fishing boat. And this man was on a body of water known as Loch Ness. And this particular man was a profound and renowned and widely known atheist. He was known for his complete rejection of anything having to do with God. And he was there in his fishing boat on Loch Ness, minding his own business, and suddenly out of nowhere came, as you might imagine, the Loch Ness Monster. And it was big and it was powerful and it took him by surprise. And the Loch Ness Monster easily took control of this man in his fishing boat and began to toss him around. And finally, as this profound, renowned atheist held on to this boat, the Loch Ness Monster threw the boat, man and all, up into the air and positioned itself underneath the boat so that as it was coming down, the man and the boat and all was going to go right in to the monster's mouth. And just before the boat arrived there, just before the boat disappeared into the monster's mouth, the man let out a cry. He said, "Oh God, please help me." Everything froze. The boat suspended in midair. Everything became still. And the man who was clinging to the boat there heard the voice of God saying, "Now wait a minute. I thought you didn't believe in me." And the man said, "Come on, God. you got to give me a break. I didn't believe in the Loch Ness Monster either until a minute ago. There's always something new to be discovered. So we are marching our way through this study, Fruitful, the Fruits of the Spirit. It's a focus on the fruits of the Spirit, or attributes seen in the character of Christ. And as disciples of Jesus, as followers of Jesus, those same fruits or same character traits are made manifest in the lives of his disciples as well. The fruits of the Spirit. Now, we should level set here just a bit and remind ourselves of what it means to be a disciple of Jesus. Being a disciple of Jesus, a follower of the way of Jesus, is a good bit more than simply an adherent. A good bit more than simply a believer. A disciple is a student, is a learner, is a practitioner of the way of Jesus. The way we've been talking about it around here, and the way Dallas Willard and John Mark Comer and others talk about it, a disciple is an apprentice of Jesus, following so closely alongside Jesus as to become more and more and more like him, become like the master. That's what it means to be a disciple. And as a disciple of Jesus, then we begin to develop this fruit, the same character of the one that we follow. So the representative list of fruits of the Spirit is found in Galatians 5. And there we read, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance or patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." And we've been marching our way through each of those fruits of the Spirit, and today we land at the fruit of goodness. Goodness. Now, the Greek word translated as goodness in Galatians 5 is agathosune. Agathosune. Now, this word only shows up in the New Testament a small handful of times, maybe four or five times at most. But its root, agathos, appears well over 100 times just in the New Testament. Agathos, the root, means good. It means good as a way of being. It is descriptive. Agathos is descriptive. It might mean excellent, for example. Or it might mean virtuous, to describe a virtuous person, a person who is kind or righteous or just or honest. It might refer to having a high ethical standard, good, or possessing personal integrity or uprightness. Agathos means good, and it is descriptive language. It is a state of being. Agathosune, on the other hand, the word that we see in Galatians 5, while encompassing everything that I just mentioned, all of those good things that I just mentioned, the spirit of that, agathosune is active. So if agathos is descriptive, is a state of being, is being good, then agathosune is doing good. It is active. So there's a difference between those two words. And even more with this word agathosune, goodness, as we see it in Galatians 5, it's not just doing good things, acting good, if you will, for its own sake, but it is doing good, choosing to do good with the forethought and the intention of benefiting someone else. So it's a very particular type of action, of goodness. There's forethought into doing good, benefiting another person. It's giving of oneself, one's time, one's attention, one's resources for the benefit of someone else on purpose, with intent. That's why this word is very often translated as generosity. Let that sink in for just a second. That is also a familiar word to us around here. Generosity, it can be said, the intentional giving away of one's time and attention and resources, the emptying of oneself for the express benefit of another, is a fruit of the Spirit. Put a little sharper point on it. When you hear us talking about generosity around here, we really are talking about something that runs much deeper than just paying the light bill. Agathosuning. So while we only see this word in the New Testament, just a handful of times, it appears in, it's played out in the New Testament time and time and time again. We see this action all over the New Testament. For example, in Luke 10, another familiar story, the story of the Good Samaritan. It reads, in reply, Jesus said, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho when he fell into the hands of robbers. They stripped him of his clothes, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. A priest happened to be going down the same road, and when he saw the man, he passed by on the other side. So too, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. When he saw him, he took pity on him, and he went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day, he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for any extra expense you may have. And Jesus goes on to finish teaching the lesson from there. Agathosune. He chose to act for the benefit of another person. His actions are generous. The early followers of Jesus that we read about in Acts, particularly in the second chapter, we see this brand of goodness, this chosen active goodness played out. They all shared their possessions and resources to meet each other's needs. Similarly, in Acts 4, it describes believers' unity and generosity, ensuring that there were no needy persons among them. They chose with intention and forethought to act with the expressed interest of others. And of course, our model, our teacher, our rabbi, Jesus, lived in a constant state of selfless goodness as he fed the hungry and healed the sick, advocated for the marginalized, and ultimately gave himself over to death, even death on a cross. This idea, goodness as a fruit of the Spirit, is about more than not getting in trouble at the dinner table. One of the most dramatic stories in the Bible, I think, which has as its core this theme of agathosune, this active, intentional goodness, is found in the parable of the sheep and the goats in Matthew 25, beginning in verse 31. If you have your Bibles, you might want to flip over to Matthew 25. It's the first book of the New Testament, if you're unfamiliar, the 25th chapter, beginning with the 31st verse. This is Jesus speaking, and he says this: when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the angels with him, he will sit on his throne in heavenly glory. All the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people one from another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, come you who are blessed by my father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? And the king will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did for one of the least of these my brothers, you did it for me. Then he will say to those on his left, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me. They also will answer, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you? And he will reply, I tell you the truth, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do for me. Then they will go away to eternal punishment, but the righteous to eternal life. So Jesus tells a story. Tells a story. He describes a scene of a final judgment where the Son of Man, the King, separates people into two groups, like a shepherd separates sheep from the goats. The sheep people are placed on his right and are commended for their righteous actions, agathosune. Their righteous actions, while the goat people are placed on his left and are condemned for their failure to act. Let's zero in on that. They were not condemned because they overtly did harm to someone else, that they set out to mistreat someone else on purpose, to wreak havoc in someone's life, to be unjust. It's not why they were condemned. They were condemned in this passage, to my understanding, for their failure to act for the good of another. Jesus said to the people on his right who were surprised to find themselves there, which is interesting to me, Lord, when did we see you? I don't remember seeing you, Lord. Jesus says, when you saw the hungry and fed them, when you saw the thirsty and gave them something to drink, when you welcomed and embraced and included the stranger, when you clothed the naked and cared for the sick and visited the imprisoned, when you acted for the express good of the people around you, the people in your line of sight, Jesus says, on purpose, intentionally, you were on point. When you were giving away your time and attention and resources, when you were emptying yourself for the good of the other, when you lived out that kind of generosity, when you chose to act, you made me proud, Jesus says. And of course, Jesus said to those people over there on the goat pile, he said, you saw it. You saw the hungry, and you saw the thirsty, and you saw the stranger, and the naked, and the sick, and the imprisoned. You saw people that you could lift up, who needed lifting up. You saw them. You saw people who needed your support. You saw people that you could liberate and ease their oppression. You saw people to whom you could deliver relief. And you didn't care enough about them, or perhaps You cared more about your own comfort and provision and convenience than you did about theirs, and you chose to turn the other way. You did not act. And Jesus says to those folks, things are going south for you. Chose to act. Chose not to act. Chose to act. Failure to act. So I don't think goodness as a fruit of the Spirit, this idea of agathosune, is difficult to comprehend. We get it. We understand what that is. But I think the crux of all of this, more than the word, is in the choosing. The choosing is the crux of it. It is easy for us. We're around halfway through the fruits of the Spirit at this point in this sermon series. It's easy for us to lull ourselves into thinking that all of this fruit bearing and all of this good doing is passive or is automatic. We sang a few minutes ago of the goodness of God. It's interesting in that song. I will sing of the goodness of God. And then we sing, your goodness is running after me. It's active. It's easy for us to think that that all of this is automatic. We can think that it's easy. We can find ourselves thinking. We can find ourselves even assuming that, okay, I have become a Christian. I'm an adherent of the Christian faith. I've been baptized. I've got a little church rhythm. I know some Bible. We've checked all of those boxes. And we think that our lives, therefore, with just those things, are magically going to bear fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. All of those things that I mentioned, being an adherent of the faith and being baptized and studying some Bible and going to church, all those things are very good. I vote yes, I am in favor. But that's not all that's called for. Every day, even when we're partied out and hot dogged out and sun drenched, every day, in order to bear fruit, we first have to choose to be with Jesus, to spend time with Jesus, to turn our eyes upon Jesus in prayer and in dialogue with the Christ. We have to choose to endeavor to be closer and closer to Jesus in order to become more and more like him. We have to apprentice under Jesus in order to become more and more like him. Then, and only then, do the fruits of the Spirit begin to appear. It's not magic. It's being a disciple. And I will admit, let's just admit, that it is it's difficult sometimes to make that choice. We don't feel like being with Jesus every day as a rhythm and as a routine. There are days I wake up, I try to do this first thing in the morning, last thing at night. And there are days that I just think I don't want to today for whatever reason. It's easy for us to do that. So in the beginning, it really does take some resolve and some commitment to do it, to show up, to show up, to show up, to show up. And pretty much it doesn't take much effort at all after a short period of time. It becomes the thing you long for, to be with Jesus. The fruits of the Spirit will come, but not without choosing to be with Jesus more and more and becoming closer and closer to Jesus and being transformed into more and more of his image, becoming more like him. And that's not easy. We're easily distracted, aren't we? We're easily distracted. I'm proud to say that that I'm so awesome that there's only two things in life that distract me. Only two things, two words in this whole universe that distract me. And that, those two things are anything and everything. We are very, very easily distracted. But even if we get over that hurdle, if we choose and we resolve to be with Jesus in order to become more like him, so fruit will come forth. Even if we get over that hurdle, even when the fruit appears, there are still choices to make over and over and over again. Are we going to leave that fruit just hanging there on the tree? Are we just going to marvel at it and relish the fact that it exists? Or are we going to take that fruit off the tree, if you will, and give it away and release it into the world for the good of others? That's a choice that we have to make. Often it is not convenient. It's easy to find ourselves just wanting to move to the other side of the road. It's often not convenient. It's not easy. It's not easy to give ourselves away for the express benefit of the other guy on purpose as a practice and as a way of life. But that is a choice that we simply must make. Agathosune. Well, here's some good news. It gets easier. I don't want to contribute to lulling you into thinking that all of this fruit bearing and fruit giving away is an easy thing to do. It's not. We understand that it's not. It's disciplined. It's disciplined and it is not an easy thing to do. And I don't want to lull you into that, but this is true. It gets easier when we choose to be transformed more and more into the image of Christ. The more like Jesus we become, the easier this active goodness becomes. In fact, it becomes our very nature. We get to the point to where we just can't help it. Connie and I had dinner with some friends of ours just a couple of nights ago, and the woman we were having dinner with, Connie knows her well, she was a work colleague, and she told us this story. She said that a few years ago, she was in a grocery store at Kroger, and she was shopping as she does there, and they headed toward the checkout line, and when she was headed toward the checkout line, she encountered a man who had his four children there. And this man was carefully selecting his groceries and putting them in the cart and seemed to be, according to our friend, doing calculations in his head. And the kids, as kids will do, for any of you who have ever taken some kids to the grocery store, they were adding some things to the cart that were not on the list. You know, some prizes, some treats, nothing outlandish, our friend said. I mean, you know, it was some gum and maybe, you know, I don't know, some candy and little things like that. Nothing really outlandish. And our friend heard the dad say to his children, okay, we're going to leave it in the cart, but when we get to checkout, we're going to buy the things we need. And if we have any money left over, I would love nothing more than to buy you some of these treats. We're going to buy the things we need, and if there's anything left over, we're going to buy these treats. Our friend was impressed. They were in line by now. She was impressed with the way this father was handling these children, and she began a conversation with him. And in that conversation, she found out, and he revealed after a little while, a little small talk, that he had the kids at the grocery store because his wife had cancer. And it was a struggle for her, and he thought that perhaps his wife could benefit from some time alone and some rest. So he brought the kids and they had come to the grocery store. And they talked a little bit more. The man's items were rung up and it turned out he didn't have any money at all for the little trinkets in his cart. And he said to his kids, I am sorry, I would love to buy this for you, but we just don't have the money for it. And our friend said, if you don't mind, can I buy that for them? Can I just buy that for them? And the man very appropriately said, that's not necessary. We're fine. We have what we need. And our friend said it looked like maybe $10 or $15 at the most in the cart. And she said, I understand. And I don't want to impose. And I don't want to insert myself into your business, but I really would like to buy these things for your children. And the man acquiesced, and she did indeed buy them. And the children, as you might imagine, were elated. They were just delighted. Yay! Yay! Look at this! Look at this! And one of them said to the other, look at this free stuff! The dad says to his children, very appropriately, there's nothing about this that's free. This woman worked hard for this money, and she chose, out of the goodness of her heart, to give you this gift. He said, the word you're looking for is thank you. And of course, the kids thanked her, and that was the end of the story. Our friend tells us that 2 years go by. And for only like the fourth or fifth time, I think she said, in her life, she was on MARTA. And she's riding MARTA, maybe to the airport, I'm not sure where she was going. And all of a sudden, this man appears out of nowhere and just sits down next to her and says, remember me? And after our friend got over being startled, she started trying to think, I don't. You know, she knows a lot of people come and go in her life. And she said, I can't place you. He said, let me give you a hint. Kroger, 4 kids. And then immediately it came back to our friend about that experience, and they began to talk. And our friend said, so tell me, how's your wife? How is she doing? And the man said, she passed away. But we're okay, he said. We're okay. It was good. We're okay. And my friend started to say, I'm sorry about this. And they were talking a little more. And the man said, look, I can't believe I ran into you. But since I have, I want to tell you one thing. I want to say thank you. I want to say thank you for buying that stuff for my kids that day. And she said, oh, it was nothing. It was just nothing. He said, I don't think you understand what I'm saying. I'm not saying thank you for the gum. I'm not saying thank you for the Skittles. I'm saying thank you for giving my entire family something else to talk about for a whole day other than my wife's cancer. Agathosune. When you actively give of yourself for the good of the other, you actually have no idea what ripple effect that's going to have. You see the thing in front of you and you act. But in the goodness of God, it ripples and ripples and ripples and ripples. So how do we claim it? How do we grasp this spirit of goodness, as well as all of the other fruits of the Spirit? They all work the same kind of way. How do we do that? And we have been saying all along, if you want to be a fruit bearer, if you want to live this kind of life, the way to it is to not climb and seek and grasp, but rather it's to surrender. It's to surrender. It's to let go of selfishness and self-centeredness. It's to let go of having the idea that you are the center of your own universe, to let go of our me first or us first kind of worldview. It is to let go of fear and insecurity. Even when fear and insecurity appear reasonable, and even when they are reasonable, there are things to fear. There are things that are real that make us feel insecure. To let go of those things and hand them over is to let go of being satisfied with a lack of spiritual depth and maturity. It's letting go of being formationally lazy or apathetic, of being complacent with spiritual mediocrity because it's easier. Letting go of that means denying yourself and taking up your cross. That means becoming an apprentice of Jesus. It's letting go of the powerful influences in this world that distract us, materialism and popularity, and ever-shifting societal norms and loud, loud, loud voices. It's letting go of those things. It's letting go of unresolved sin and guilt. It's letting go of shame. That's how you claim this life. Now, I want to tell you that I know surrender is not easy either. Surrender is not easy either. It's not natural for us. You know, when babies are born, you might remember this, they're born with a reflex. I think it's called the Palmer reflex. And anytime a baby or an infant feels a little pressure right here on their hand, they just grasp. That's the reflex, is to just grasp, is to just cling. Now, I know for those of us who are parents and who have had babies, we love to think that, oh, my baby loves me. Oh, my baby's holding on to me. And that's true. Let's keep that myth going. I'm going to keep that going. But the fact is, it's a reflex. You're born with the reflex to grasp and to cling. A baby has to learn to let go. That's a learned behavior. We have to learn to let go too. Let go. Surrender. Bear fruit. Be good. Amen and amen. Maybe there's someone here today, and you know that there are things in your life that you just need to let go of. You just need to let go of the fear, of the insecurity, or of the shame, of the sin and the guilt, of the distraction. You just need to let go of it. And once and for all, decide and resolve to give yourself over to the fullness of Christ. The entirety of yourself over to the fullness of Christ. I'm going to invite you to respond however you may. At the end of our service today, our pastors will be here at the front. They'll be glad to talk with you, be glad to pray with you. And you come and you surrender, and they'll be here. But now as we prepare to leave, I ask you, if you are able to stand, and as we prepare to leave this place, may Christ go before you to prepare your way. Christ go behind you on the days when you feel like retreating, to encourage you one step forward at a time. Christ go to your right and to your left, abiding closer than even a brother or a sister. Christ go above you on the days when dark clouds roll in, to remind you there is one above the clouds, who at the end of the day has the final word. Christ go beneath you, girding you with confidence and removing all forms of fear. But mostly, Christ go in you, transforming you from the inside out until your hearts beat in rhythm with His.
All my life you have been faithful. So